Okay, thank you everybody for coming on. And of course, as always, thank you, Miriam, for organizing and scheduling and putting together the flyer. And the greatest part is actually keeping me on task, which is far easier said than done. So thank you very much to Miriam. The topic for this month's session is Chanukah. There are a number of wonderful questions that were submitted. And I'll go through the list. I'm sure there'll be plenty of time at the end. And then obviously we'll open it up for any kind of follow-up questions that people might have. Question number one, when exactly is a person supposed to light the Chanukah candles? Now, this question of when is a person supposed to light the Chanukah candles is, it's clear from the context of the question, is being asked ideally. When is the ideal time to light Chanukah candles? And like any good Jewish question, the answer is different opinions. The basic answer is Tzei Sekel Chavim, which, just to give everybody a sense, is the time that we would end Shabbos, for example, or the time that they say, you know, repeat Kriyat Shema after such a time in Shul. That's really the ideal time to light Chanukah candles. There are opinions that say, see, there's a lot of uncertainty in halacha about what exactly is defined as night. You have all kinds of different opinions. So there are opinions that say you should light Chanukah candles 15 minutes after sunset or a half hour after sunset. The bottom line is the most sort of standard opinion is to light it at Tzei Sekel Chavim. To give people a sense, this year Chanukah, basically Tzei Sekel Chavim is 5:30. So 5:30 would be the ideal, I would say, would be the ideal time to light Chanukah candles. Now, what's important to keep in mind, I'm sure we'll get into this in some way later tonight, there's a famous idea that the Chanukah candles are supposed to burn for a half hour. What's important to keep in mind is even the opinions that say that you should light the Chanukah candles a little bit before, say, Sekel Chavim, they're all saying that as some type of stringency. So if you light it at 5:30, you light it at 5:30 and it should burn at least until 6. That's it. If you light it at 5:15, it should still burn until 6. In other words, the ones that say you light earlier than Tzei Sekel Chavim, they're not totally sold on that. They're sort of saying it as a stringency. Maybe you should light it a little bit earlier than Tzei Sekel Chavim, but they still would tell you that you need to have it burn for a half hour after Tzei Sekel Chavim. So again, there are various opinions, but just trying to stay kind of like standard and basic, I would encourage Tzei Sekel Chavim, which is the time the Shabbos is over, which for during Chanukah, really throughout Chanukah, it's just around 5:30. That is topic number one. Item number two, what's the story about doing work while the candles are lit? What is the halacha about doing work while the candles are lit? This is a very good question. My guess is some of the people on this Zoom don't have the faintest idea what I'm talking about right now, and some of the people do. And there's a good reason why some of the people don't have the faintest idea what I'm talking about. The reason why some of the people don't have the faintest idea what I'm talking about is it's not a halacha that you're not allowed to do work during the candle lighting, during the time the candles are burning. It's a minhag. It's a practice that many people have. It is a minhag brought in Shulchan Aruch. It's a real minhag, but it's not an absolute obligation. But many people have the practice that women, specifically women, don't do work during the half hour, the first half hour that the candles are burning. Okay? I'm sure there are women who would tell you that many men don't do work the rest of the year. That's probably also true. But many, many women don't do work the half hour while the candles are burning. What do we mean when we say work? So the general guideline that I tell people is the kind of things that one would be prohibited from doing on Chol HaMoed. So it's okay to walk into a room and flip on a light switch. You know, if a person was building a bookshelf, that's not the time to be doing it. If they have this minute, the half hour during Chanukah candles, that's not the time to be building a bookshelf. You know, if a person wants to text someone something or another, that's fine. It could be that a person shouldn't be doing, let's say, laundry during that half hour. But I want to clarify, it's specifically for women. It's not the standard practice, is not the whole time the candles are burning. It's that half hour, that first half hour the candles are burning. And it's not that they can't do anything. It's specifically things that you wouldn't do in normal circumstances on Chol HaMoed. But malacha activities that are sort of standard living type activities that are not considered labor in the context of Chol HaMoed would be fine to do, even if one has the minhag. Person can work on supper during that time, for example. Ironically, if a person would have this practice, this would not be a good time to be writing things on a piece of paper if a person has that practice, because writing is very questionable on Chol HaMoed, as I'm sure many of you know. So that's kind of how it plays out. Okay. What's the story with eating before candle lighting? So let me give you a few scenarios just to think about this. Scenario number one, you have a family. Looked at the cyber brief duly sent out by Menashe Katz. It says candle lighting ideally is 5:30, but they would like for everybody to light together, which I think is reasonable. There's certainly a concept of publicizing the miracle. You could publicize the miracle to each other on Chanukah. They want to wait for everybody to come home. So somebody's not going to get home until 6:30. Okay. So, but the rest of the family is sitting around them. So question number one, are you allowed to eat at 5:30? Are you allowed to eat dinner at 5:30? Are you allowed to have a snack at 5:30? Or do we say once the time for the mitzvah of Chanukah has come, mitzvah of Chanukah candles has come, you're not supposed to do any work? That's question number one. Question number two, a person's on the way home. Person's driving home. They get stuck in crazy traffic and this and that. Thanksgiving weekend, they're on their way home Sunday night of Thanksgiving weekend, first night of Chanukah. You know, they're not, it's not moving. They'd love to have some pretzels. It's 5:30 already. Is that okay? Is that not okay? If it's not okay, from what time is it not okay? We might talk about another scenario or two later in the evening. So here's the basic halacha. The basic halacha is once the time for Chanukah candles comes, a person is supposed to refrain from eating hamotzi or mazonos, from eating bread or a type of thing you would make mazonos on, cake, cookies, pretzels, crackers, Cheerios, things of that sort. Person is supposed to refrain from eating such things. A kibetz is a relatively small amount. Person is supposed to refrain from eating these things from the time of candle lighting, from the time that one is supposed to be lighting the candles. The rationale is a very basic rationale. There's a concern in halacha. A person will lose track of time. A person will get carried away, whatever they're eating. I'll publicly confess there many times I sit down to have a bite, and after an extended period of time, I'm still sitting down. I'm still having many bites, and you sort of have a way of losing yourself and losing your focus and forgetting what you were going to do next. That's the basic halacha. Now, I should also say that it's also the halacha for, let's say, starting to learn a subject of Torah. It's 5:30. It's time to light the Hanukkah candles. The same way that you're not supposed to start eating a substantive thing then. It's not correct to start, open up a Gemara and start learning the Daf Yomi then. It's also not correct at that time. And the general idea is general type of activities that would be very engaging and very distracting, and a person might totally forget what's what afterwards. A person's not supposed to do that from the time that one is supposed to light the Chanukah candles until one actually lights the Chanukah candles. But I think the most applicable ones are eating and the study of Torah. Now, for many such halachos, it doesn't begin at the time of the mitzvah. It begins from actually a half hour before the mitzvah begins, because we're worried that once you get started, you'll get totally sidetracked in this and that and the other. So there are authorities that say it's not only true from 5:30, it's actually true from 5 o'clock and on. There are authorities that say that as well. This, on the face of it, is not a minhag or a stringency. This is actually a basic halacha. My guess is that many of you are somewhat surprised at what I'm saying. So is there any practical exception to this? So here's what I would say. What I'm about to say, it's something I've discussed with the Rebbeinu Zichrono Livracha various times over the years. I'm very confident that I'm about to say is in step with halachic decisions that he shared with me in the past. I don't know that everybody says these things, but this is what I would tell you. And that's as follows. The whole concept of not starting to eat until you light is out of concern that you're going to forget about it. So let's say there's a built-in reminder. So let's say, for example, I'm going to sit and have a piece of cake and you're not going to have cake. Your job is to make sure that once I'm finished with the cake, I don't forget to light Chanukah candles. So that would be okay. Because even if I get carried away, you're focused. So the most common scenario that a person is waiting to light Chanukah candles is because they're waiting for someone to come home. So if I sit down and I start eating supper, I might be distracted. But if the person that I'm waiting for is still coming home, then when they walk in the door, their primary focus is, okay, it's time to light the menorah. So they'll remind me. So I think it's very reasonable to be lenient about this if there's somebody coming home. I asked Rabbi Einemer, Zichron Levrach, I definitely remember asking Rabbi Einemer, the scenario, a person is driving home, they're very hungry, this, that, may they eat in the car on the way home? So he felt, also, it's one thing when you're sitting at your dining room table, you might get carried away, you might forget what your goal was after you ate, but my gosh, you're on your way home. It's not that we think your plan is going to be to stay in the car the rest of the night. You're noshing in the car, and then when you get to your desired destination, you'll move on. At that point, presumably the person will recalibrate and remember that it's time to light the Chanukah candles. So Rabbi Einemer felt that if there's somebody coming home who wants to come home, you're going to light, that's an okay enough reminder. If you're eating on the way home, then we're not worried you'll forget. I also tell people that in the spirit of all these other things that we've mentioned, if I have a built-in reminder, it should also be okay. So if I set an alarm on my phone to remind me, you know, to that I have to light at a certain time, or I leave a note for myself in a place that I'm sure I'm out. I'm out at some event, and I'd like to eat at the event, by the way. And I'm going to light Chanukah candles when I come home. So I put a note for myself in big letters, menorah, you know, in a place that I absolutely will see upon my entry into the house. So I think all those things would be okay. But absent all of the above, from 5:30 and on, a person shouldn't eat a kibbetza of bread or mazonos. A person may nosh on fruit and vegetables. A person may have a drink. If it's no big deal to wait just a little bit longer before, you know, having your spaghetti and meatballs, better to wait. But if it's difficult in any way, I think we listed off a number of leniencies that would apply. And like I said, there are definitely authorities who say, the Shaar HaTzion discusses this, the definite authorities that say that it actually wouldn't begin from 5:30, it would begin from 5 o'clock, because normally this halacha of we're worried you'll get distracted kicks in a half hour before the mitzvah begins. So that's how that all plays out. This is a very interesting question that's being posed. In order for everyone to appreciate the question, I have to give a little bit of an introduction. One of the core concepts of lighting the menorah is Pirsume Nisa. Pirsume Nisa means publicizing the miracle. Okay. To whom am I trying to publicize the miracle? So the Ramah says that standard Ashkenazi practice today in our times is that the primary audience to whom I'm publicizing the miracle is the people in my own home. Okay? So it should be that when I light the menorah, hopefully somebody else in the house, if there are other people living in the home, there might not be anyone else who lives in the home. Person might live alone. But if there are other people living in the home, it's ideal that other people should see the menorah when I light. It could be that they'll see it at the moment that I'm lighting it. It could be that they'll see it much later, sometime during the subsequent half hour. But that's ideal. Let's say there are people in the house who can see my menorah. Let's say there's not people in the house who can see my menorah. Either way, it's certainly very nice for me to light my menorah in a position that people from the outside will see my menorah. So that's, most of us, of course, are in the habit of lighting by a window so that passersby can see our menorah. Okay. Let's say regulars at Mincha Maariv surely have heard me say this scenario many times over the years. When Atara and I first were married, we were living in University Towers, in a one-bedroom apartment that provided one window to the outside, and there was a pretty big tree right in front of that window. So I'm very confident that if we were to light menorah by that window, nobody other than the two of us would see that menorah. That's okay. But the point is, there was no opportunity to publicize to the people outside. So the question that's posed in this question is, oh, I should say one more thing, excuse me. So that's if a person's tree is blocking the window. Let's say a person has a wonderful window facing the parking lot or facing the street. The only thing is, they live on the 10th floor. Who cares if they live on the 10th floor? So the rabbis have a concept in general, the rabbis of the Talmud have a concept in general, that if something is above 20 amos from the ground, the assumption is that people's eyes will not carry high enough that it'll actually be noticed by them. 20 amos is anywhere from 30 to 40 feet. If a person lives on the 10th floor of an apartment building, if they're lighting by the window so that people on the street level can see, the assumption is, that's definitely more than 20 amos from the street level, the assumption is people aren't going to see on the street level. So what we would say is, halachically, there's really not a value in lighting by the window on such a high floor. Now, it's okay to light when no one from the outside can see. If a member of our household can see, you're publicizing the miracle to the member of the household. Rabbi Einar Zichron of Racha was very adamant that if a person lives alone, so if the mitzvah of publicizing the miracle is to the members of the household, so it's publicizing it to myself. And that's okay too. I shouldn't rely on that if there are other members of the household. I should light in a way to publicize it to them. But if I live alone and the only person who can see the menorah is me, that's also okay. So the question that the person's posing is, they live in a high floor of the apartments. The standard lighting by the window doesn't make sense for them because they're so high up. Does it make sense to take their menorah and light it on the ground level of the apartment building? Does that make sense? Does it make sense to take the menorah downstairs, I don't know, light it in the lobby, something like that? Does that make sense? Because the rationale is, plenty of people will see it in the lobby. It's a very good question. What I would say for that is, it's not correct to go light it in the lobby, because the nature of the mitzvah of Chanukah is I'm supposed to light it in my home. And the lobby is an extension of my home, but the lobby is an area connected to all these different people. I should light it in a place that I live in. I don't live in my lobby. I live in the apartment. So I would say it's highly questionable if a person can be yotzei by lighting in the lobby of the building. And a person is definitely yotzei by lighting in their apartment, even if nobody from the outside can see it. So it's certainly preferable, and possibly not even acceptable, to light in the lobby. It's certainly, at the very least, preferable to light in the apartment. Now, there's one more halach about lighting in the apartment. If there's no good place to light so that people from the outside can see, there is a prescribed place to light within the apartment, which is by, on the inside of my apartment, by the front door of my apartment, on the side opposite the mezuzah. So that on one side of the front door is the mezuzah, on the other side of the front door is my menorah, and then the entry to my home is surrounded by mitzvos. Now, for whatever reason, there's not a good space to put it over there, or I'm scared that it's dangerous if I put it over there, it's fine. I can light it anywhere I want within the apartment. Just all things being equal, there's a preference of lighting in that place. Okay, I hope I answered that question. Okay. Okay. This is really probably one of the most compelling questions for Chanukah. I get asked this numerous times every year, and I am sure no matter how many times, no matter how many people watch the recording of this Ask the Rabbi, I will be asked this numerous times this year, which is great, but this is a very, very valid question. A person is invited to a wedding on a night of Chanukah. What are they supposed to do? How does this work? Should they light at the wedding? Should they light at home? Should they light before they go to the wedding? Should they light after they come home from the wedding? Should they just always respond in the RSVP, I don't go to weddings on Chanukah? What should they do? So there are numerous options. Personally, I would tell you, as a general rule of thumb, a person should not light at the wedding. There could be scenarios where it's okay, but my general advice to people in most scenarios is it doesn't make sense to light at the wedding. And let me tell you why I would say that. I think we already touched on it. The mitzvah of Chanukah is to light the candles in the place that I live. Okay, I don't live at the wedding hall. Okay, so I should light it in my home. Now, wait a second. Are you telling me that if I go out of town for Chanukah, I have to go back home every night? What are you telling me? No, I'm not saying that. There's such a thing as defining something as being someone's temporary residence. What defines one's temporary residence? So there are different opinions in halacha. It could be the place that one is eating is defined as one's temporary residence. It could be the place that one is sleeping is defined as one's temporary residence. There's different opinions about it, but I'll tell you, the fact that I'm having dinner in this big wedding hall, it's somewhat of a stretch to say the wedding hall is my spot for tonight. Sounds a little funny. I'll tell you where I think the question of eating versus sleeping is most relevant. I'll give you a scenario that comes up a lot. There's a family get together for Shabbos Chanukah. You can't fit all of the family members in one house. So the meals are all at one person's home. And that's really central headquarters for the family get together. That's where people are going to sit and schmooze, and that's where the meals are going to be, and so on and so forth. The only thing is, people are farmed out all over the neighborhood for where they're sleeping Friday night. So I ask you, what's the person's temporary home Friday night of Chanukah? In such a situation, it's very fair to say the place that the person is eating, the place where the meals are taking place, that's the person's primary base for this night of Chanukah. Now, sometimes it could be argued that the place that they're sleeping is their primary base. That's a reasonable argument as well. But for example, if a person went out of town to this wedding, if they're going to be sleeping in a place that they'll be able to light the menorah, it probably would make the most sense to light in the place that they're sleeping, because that's where they're really staying that night. That's their personal place that night. Now, if they're sleeping in a hotel that night, so the hotel, they're not going to let them light a candle in the hotel. That's not going to work. And remember, the mitzvah of Chanukah candles is it should burn for a half hour. So that's a bad idea. You're not going to light it. You know, they're not going to let you light candles for a half hour. No way. And I would certainly not encourage a person to stay in a hotel and not observe their rules and regulations. Certainly not appropriate. So then you could say, okay, the place that I'm sleeping tonight, I can't even light menorah there. The wedding hall is the place that I'm eating dinner. In that situation, I think it would be reasonable to light. Sometimes they offer menorahs to guests at the wedding. I think in that specific situation, it would be reasonable to light a menorah at the wedding. But if a person is going home that night, they really should light menorah once they get home, even if it's very late. A person can light menorah anytime during the night, as long as it's before dawn, as long as someone will see the menorah. And I reiterate that if a person lives alone, if they themselves see the menorah, it's okay. Okay, I know I'm throwing a lot at you, and we're still not done with this question. So there's another scenario. I'll share with you that I, God willing, I hope to attend a wedding in New York one of the nights of Chanukah. Plan on going alone. Atara will be home with the kids, God willing. My plan is to drive back home that night. I hope it'll work out. It could be I'll end up staying at a motel on the way home, and I won't even, you know, I mean, it could be I'll just be too tired. We'll see. So I'm going to do something else, God willing. There's a fascinating halacha about Hanukkah candles, which is being that the core obligation is on the home. If a Tara has me in mind when she lights, and I have in mind to be Yotze with the Tara, I'm Yotze Hanukkah candles that night. Even if I didn't hear it, even if I didn't see it. So that's actually what I plan on doing that night with the wedding. Now, if it was just a wedding in Baltimore or something, I would just light when I came home. But I'm worried either that I'll come home very late and nobody from the house will be up. And so then it's questionable, you know, if I could light with a bracha at that point, I probably couldn't. And I'm also worried I might even end up not coming home that night. I might just end up staying in the hotel, but I really can't light with a bracha then because they won't even let me light. So that's another option. If a person is going to be away that night, if a member of the household is going to be home, just ask the member of the household to light with you in mind. And then you're Yotze. Now I'll add that if there's somebody at the wedding lighting with a bracha, there's a benefit in my asking them to just have me in mind when they make the brachas, and I'll listen to the brachas and say amen. So I'm kind of living vicariously on two levels in terms of the mitzvah of the actual lighting in my home. My wife is lighting with me in mind. And in terms of being able to make the brachos, I can't make the brachos because it's brachos in vain because I already fulfilled the mitzvah with my wife's lighting, but I could say amen to the person's brachos. That's something. But the primary issue is the issue of the candles being lit in my home with me in mind. There's yet another option. The ideal time to light the Chanukah candles is to say Sakul Chavim, but that's not the only time. I can, and we spoke about how much later I can light the candles. I can light the candles earlier than say Sefer Chavim. I'm allowed to light the candles as early as Plag HaMincha. Plag HaMincha, to just give you a context, you know, in the summer, you know, it says, don't light candles before such and such a time. That time is Plag HaMincha. That's a time during the day, but it's like the last leg of the day that for various halachos, nighttime-oriented things, I'm like allowed to start a little bit early. If I remember correctly, Menashe, please spot me on this one, if you don't mind. If I remember correctly, Plag HaMincha, we said it's like 3:50 or something during Hanukkah. If I'm getting it wrong, if it's not too much trouble. 3:47. Okay, give me some credit. I mean, you know, thank you, Menashe. Thank you very much. So I'm allowed to light as early as Plag HaMincha, but if I light that early, remember we said that when I light at 5:30, it's supposed to burn until 6 o'clock. So if I light at 3:47, I have to have enough fuel with the candles that should burn until six. Now, we rely on this halacha every year. Friday night. I don't light Hanukkah candles Friday night at Seis HaKochavim. It's already Shabbos. I can't light Hanukkah candles anymore. So we light Hanukkah candles, by the way, we light Hanukkah candles before we light Shabbos candles, because once a woman lights Shabbos candles, she's accepting Shabbos. So she can't light Hanukkah candles after she lights Shabbos candles. So she lights Hanukkah candles first, or one lights Hanukkah candles first, and then the Shabbos candles are lit. So I shouldn't light before 3:47. And I should make sure that there's enough fuel in the candles to burn until 6 o'clock, which means, with all due respect to my extremely esteemed predecessor's yeshiva, the Tell's yeshiva candles are not good for Friday night of Hanukkah. Even if you eat the charoses while the candles are burning, it's still not good enough. So it's not good for a Friday night of Hanukkah, because those candles are wonderful for Hanukkah, but they only burn a little bit more than a half hour, about a half hour. Now, I want to remind everybody that technically speaking, all you need is one member of the household to light Hanukkah candles. As long as everyone has in mind to be yotze with that person, everyone's yotze with that one lighting. So, for example, in our home, thank God, on a normal night of Hanukkah, we have various Hanukkah menorahs being lit, thank God. But Friday night of Hanukkah, we need more than just those simple candles. So what we normally do is, for that, we just have one menorah. And I just light on everybody's behalf. Everyone gathers around and I light. Whether one lights one menorah, whether one lights many menorahs Friday night, it's essential that if a person's making a bracha on the candles, at least one candle, because that's the basic obligation, needs to be lit, that it should burn until 6 o'clock. But the same option is there if you're going to a wedding. I want to just raise one more issue that kind of doubles back to something we spoke about before. So let's say I decide I'm going to light when I get home from the wedding. Whatever, we're definitely coming home that night. Somebody will be up, a few of us are going together, whatever it is. I'm going to light when I get home from the wedding. So am I allowed to eat at the wedding or not? We already said that once 5:30 comes, you're not supposed to eat dinner in normal circumstances until you light. But I'm not going to light until 10 o'clock at night. So what's the story? So I remind you again of what we spoke about with creating reminders for myself. So let me figure out what time is my estimate that I will be home. Be nice and conservative about it, or I don't know, you know, be confident that the time that I'm designating is a time that I'll be home, and set my alarm to remind myself to light at that time, or leave a note for myself that I'll definitely see when I walk in the house. So again, the reminder is in place, and then it should be all right to eat before I light. International flight, a person's leaving, person is supposed to leave for the airport at 3:20. So it's before plag that they're leaving. So obviously, if you think about it, many of the options, you know, and they're landing in Israel or wherever, by the time the plane lands, it's going to be daytime the next day. Right? So what's the story with that? Many of the options that we mentioned would certainly be relevant in this case. I want to reiterate that if there's a member of the household who's staying behind, if that person lights with me in mind, I'm fully yotze. So that's obviously the easiest solution. The worst solution is to bring a menorah onto the plane with me. That's the worst solution, and light it, that's bad. It's nice if the person believes that there'll be a Hanukkah miracle and they'll be allowed to stay on the flight the rest of the way. But it's bad on many levels, safety and everything. But let's say the whole family is going. So nobody's staying behind in the house. And again, a person leaves for the airport before the earliest time they can light. By the time they land, it'll be too late. So Rabbi Einar Zichron Avracha used to talk about just even turning on an electric light at the appropriate time with Hanukkah in mind. You could bring a flashlight with you. You could even press the light, you know, above you in the seat in the airplane. What I would say is you should not make a bracha on that. It's interesting. I'm sure many people have had circumstances, let's say being in the hospital or it's all over Shabbos, and maybe a person has heard leniencies about, let's say, making bracha on some electric lights, probably not an LED light, but other types of electric lights. Chanukah, we're more strict about it than Shabbos, because Shabbos is about having light. So there's all kinds of ways to have light. Chanukah is about recreating what happened in the menorah of the Beis HaMikdash, of the temple. And that was like literally lighting a flame. So even if we're inclined to light with a bracha for Shabbos candles, or to make a bracha on electric candles, generally speaking, halach authorities don't have one make a bracha on electric candles for Chanukah. But even if one isn't making a bracha, one could certainly turn on the light and have Chanukah in mind. So that's what I would say for the international flight. Okay. We touched on part of this, but I just want to revisit part of the question. I'm staying in someone's home over Chanukah. We discussed a complicated question about family get-togethers and the place of eating, the place of sleeping. Let's go simpler this time. I'm staying at your house. I'm staying at your house Tuesday night of Chanukah. I'm sleeping in the same house as I'm eating, and I'm your guest for Tuesday night of Chanukah. Okay, so first of all, let me just clarify one point. Sometimes I'm leaving. I always get asked questions like this. Someone just asked me a question today. They're leaving for New York at 6:00. Great. Light your menorah at home at 5:30. Let it burn for a half hour. By the way, once it's burned for a half hour, it's okay to blow out the Chanukah candles. If you're scared about leaving it burning with no one in the house, once it's burned, you have to make sure it's burned for a half hour. So light for a half hour, blow it out, and then be on your way. You fulfilled the mitzvah. Even though you're not sleeping there that night, that's your real house. You're always yotze when you light in your home. This stuff about where you're sleeping is when I need to define temporary homes. But if I'm actually going to be home at the time of Chanukah candles, and I'm going to be home long enough to let it burn for a half hour, I should light at 5:30, let it burn for a half hour, blow it out, and be on my way. That would be the ideal solution. But I'm not. I'm leaving at 3:00 in the afternoon. So it's clear where I should light that night. I should light at your house. That's where I'm sleeping. That's where I'm eating my food. You're my temporary home for that night of Chanukah. What are my options? Obviously, if you offer me a menorah, or if I bring a menorah along with me, obviously I could light and make brachos for saying that your house is my temporary abode for that night. So I can fulfill my mitzvah of Chanukah in your home. Let's say you're not offering me a menorah. Let's say it's awkward. By the way, let's say I'm staying at your house for Shabbos. It's already complicated with all the candles and this and that. I don't want to trouble you. Is there a way for me to be yotze with your lighting? So just to repeat, if we're actually really members of the same household and we're all at home, of course I can be yotze with your lighting. This is a different question because I'm not a member of your household. I'm just staying there tonight. I'm not part of your unit. So fine, your house is the place for me to light and be yotze, but I'm not lighting, you're lighting. How does that work? So this is the halacha that I could give you whatever, 10 cents a quarter, whatever it is, and ask you if I could purchase a portion of your Chanukah candles. And so then, if I purchase a portion of your Chanukah candles, then I'm like buying into your project. And I can be yotze with your lighting, if you have me in mind when you light. Now, I should make it my business to be present for the lighting in that case. Again, when I'm a member of your household, when I'm an actual member of your household, not just a visitor, then I'm yotze with your lighting, even if I'm not there when you light. But if I'm just paying you just to latch on to you, then I should really be present when you light. And again, you have in mind to be motzi me, and I have in mind to be yotze with you. Okay, I hope I answered that question. Okay, so this is a good segue into the next question. This is an interesting question. A person has a child who the vast majority of the year is not living in their Silver Spring home. They're away at college, they're away at yeshiva, whatever it is. and they're going to be home for a night of Chanukah. So here's the question. They obviously can light menorah in their parents' home. That's their official residence. They're a student where they are. They're just, you know, their official residence is their parents' home. They certainly can light a biyotze. If I'm just staying in your house for a night, I can be yotze. Of course, if a child comes home to the parents' home, of course they could be yotze in the parents' home. But here's the question. Let's say they're not lighting their own menorah. Can they be yotze with their parents' lighting? So if they're really a member of the household, they can definitely be yotze with their parents' lighting, even if they're not home at the time. But they're not really a member of their parents' household. Let me put it to you this way. When the child is in school in New York, I ask you, should they light menorah in their, wherever they are in their dormitory or wherever in New York? Or are they just automatically yotze every night of Chanukah with their parents' lighting? I'll ask you better. The child is in seminary or yeshiva in Israel. Do they need to light a menorah in their house? In their dormitory? Or are they just automatically yotze with their parents being lighting in Silver Spring? I'm sure many of you would agree with me. Intuitively, it sounds funny to say that the child who's abroad most of the year is automatically yotze with their parents lighting. It sounds a little strange. On the other hand, it is the house that they, you know, it's the address on their driver's license. I mean, this is like their home in some sense. So I'll tell you how I would look at it. When they're actually home in Silver Spring, I would see their parents' home as their home. But when they're not home in Silver Spring, and again, this is someone with a real kfios, a real established residence elsewhere in a dormitory or something. When they're not home in Silver Spring, I would not see their parents' home as their home. So if your child is away at college, I do not think your child is yotze with you lighting at home. But if your child is home, I think it's very reasonable. When they're home, I think it's very reasonable to consider that part of their, to consider them as part of the household. So if it's like Shabbos of Chanukah and they're home with you for Shabbos, so I would say that they are naturally yotze with the head of household lighting, and they don't have to contribute money to connect to that. That's what I personally would say. But that's because your home address is on some level still their address. Thank God, I'm definitely established in my own right, and the address on my driver's license is not my parents' home address. If we came over as a family for Friday, let's say we slept over at my parents' home for Shabbos Chanukah, I would say that I would need to pay to be connected to my parents' Chanukah lighting. Because I'm really not a member of the household. I'm a member of their extended family, thank God. But I'm not a member of their household. But a college or yeshiva student visiting, I still think they consider themselves a member of the household, at least when they're home. That's what I would say. I hope that made sense. I could definitely imagine others giving different answers, but that would be my guidance. Okay, I've only got one more question, then we'll open up the floor. Okay, a lot of this fits into points that have been raised already. So if a person is traveling by car Chanukah night, so what do they do with lighting? So they want to know if they go to shul for Maariv, they catch a shul for Maariv, can they be yotze with the menorah lighting in shul? You know, like in shul, but in Mincha Maariv, we light Chanukah candles. So they're really not yotze with that. Actually, nobody's yotze with the Chanukah candles in shul, because it's no one's home. I mean, if somebody lived in the shul, they'd be yotze with it. But it's no one's home. The reason why we light Chanukah candles in shul is for another reason. It's because it's a public gathering on Chanukah in a place of prayer. It reminds us of the Beis HaMikdash. So the person traveling is not yotze with the Chanukah candles in shul being lit. So the person wants to know if they should light one candle in a non-smoking motel room, assuming the motel room does not allow candles to be lit, which I think is a fair assumption. I would not say that's a good idea. If there's someone staying home, as we've said various times already, ask that person to light with you in mind. This happens all the time, people on business trips and the like. If there's no one staying home, it's an onus. It's beyond your control. What can you do? You don't have a context in which you could light Hanukkah candles that night. Now, if you eat out at a kosher restaurant that night, and they have a place in the kosher restaurant that people can light menorah, so that's part of your temporary residence that night, because that's where you're eating dinner. So if the place that you're sleeping isn't going to fly, so you could eat in the place that you're eating, you could light in the place you're eating dinner. But assuming that's not an option, or assuming you just bought some food, you're going to eat it in the hotel room. So it's an onus. It's beyond your control. You're like the person who's on the international flight. And then too, I would say, so turn on an electric light. But don't make a bracha on it. Okay, so that's the questions. These were wonderful, wonderful questions. I think we covered a lot of ground. Thanks to the questions that people posed. Thank you to all the people who submitted questions. I'm going to start with the chats. And people can feel free to keep on putting questions in our chat. And God willing, once I get through the chat, people will be given the opportunity to just call out questions. That's interesting, Menashe. Thank you. Oh, what a good question. I get asked this frequently. I'm not going to say the question out loud because I'm scared I'm going to answer it wrong. I have to look it up. Are you asking this theoretically, Menashe, or actually?
This may be an actual issue for one.
So I think the halacha is that you don't say the bracha, but if you remind me, please, I'll double check. Okay.
Thank you.
I'm being intentionally vague because I'm scared I'm going to say the wrong thing. But I think that's a great question. It's definitely brought down a lot. I just always forget. I think you don't say the bracha. Yeah. Okay. There is nothing else that is coming in the chat. Anyone want to call out any questions?
I'll throw out one of my comments, which is the real reason you can't light a menorah on an airplane is because the amount of oil you would need to bring would be beyond the amount of liquid you can bring on a flight.
Good. That's very good. Thank you very much. That's excellent. Sue?
Why do you light candles, Hanukkah candles, and shul if everybody has to go home and do it?
Yeah, it's a great question. So for shul, the answer at the very least is we're so focused on the Beis HaMikdash, and the shul is like our microcosm of the Beis HaMikdash, you know, the Hanukkah menorah from the Beis HaMikdash, you know, from the Hanukkah story. So it just seems appropriate to light in shul as well to commemorate. It's another way of commemorating it. Now, And that's such an ingrained minhag and klal yisrael that we make a bracha on it, even though no one's yotze with it. Now, the real interesting question, we discussed this already in shul this year, but it always comes up. You have different opinions about it. So what should I extrapolate from the fact that we make the bracha when we light in shul? Is it a shul thing? Or is it every time you have a public gathering on Hanukkah, you can make a bracha on lighting Hanukkah candles? So if you say it's a shul thing, it's a shul thing. If you say it's about public gatherings, then wow. So if I like invite a bunch of people to view a menorah lighting in some public place on Hanukkah, I can make a bracha on that too. Even if I'm not yotzei my personal mitzvah, I still need to light when I get home, but I could, it's a publicizing of the miracle, which is of course core to the Hanukkah mitzvah. And this is, so for example, Chabad definitely holds that it's not just a shul halacha, it's anytime there's a public gathering. And that's why, you know, there's the very well-known lighting in D.C. Chabad has lightings throughout the world in a public way. So they clearly are of the school of thought, because they make brachos at it normally. Clearly the general Chabad approach is to make a bracha, that which is, it's a very understandable argument. Other halakhic opinions say, listen, if you want to light a menorah, it's very nice to light a menorah. It's a nice publicized miracle, but they wouldn't necessarily make a bracha on it. But you get different opinions about it. But kind of shul is sort of like the beginning of the discussion in a sense. Yeah, thank you for raising that. Okay, let's see. There was another chat that came in. Okay, Menasha, thanks for asking me a question. I know the answer to. It's so when I know the answer, I'll tell everybody what you asked. A person who lights the Chanukah candles in shul on Chanukah still needs to go home and make the brachos when he lights at home because he hasn't been yosef mitzvah. That wasn't your question. Menashe's question is, the guy who lights in shul first night Chanukah makes a shechianu. So then he goes home to light in his own home. He definitely makes the other brachos of Chanukah candles. Does he make the Shechianu when he goes home to light? So for that, we say he does not make a second Shechianu when he goes home. He makes the other brachos, but he does not make the second Shechianu. Thank you for asking that. Any other questions? Okay. Well, okay. So thank you very much, everybody, for joining us. And thank you for submitting questions, all those who submitted questions. I have a question for you. Thank God, hopefully we'll meet, hopefully approximately in a month from now. We need to think about what the next topic would be. I've mentioned some others in the past. I would like to suggest something that someone mentioned to me in a totally different context, but I think this venue would be good for it. What do people think about a session about Lashon Hara? I mean, we could go around, everyone could submit their favorite pieces of gossip beforehand. I could read it. People could chat in, what they think about it. We could go around. But there are a lot of good, I think this venue actually would be great for it, because what I would hope would people would present theoretical scenarios or actual scenarios that they wonder about sometimes. So I think that might be very instructive in a way. This venue, I think, would be more applicable, I think, than a lot of other contexts. Okay, I'm getting good feedback. So maybe the next time we'll, and then, by the way, if it's a boring presentation, you'll know what you are and are not allowed to say about it afterwards. Mm-hmm. Okay, so...
We keep quiet.
So God willing, the next time we'll do... the topic will be Lashon Hara, and I'm sure Miriam will be kind enough to keep me on task regarding scheduling a date and making a flyer and the like. Okay, thank you very much, everybody. A happy Chanukah to everybody. Take care.
Happy Chanukah to you, Rabbi.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rabbi.
Thank you.
Happy Chanukah.
Thank you.